Well, good morning and welcome to our Power Breakfast interview. Now, the scourge of Ebola is spreading and alarming. Almost 4,000 people dead in West Africa from the virus. And there are indications that, especially from the World Health Organization, that many countries in this region are unprepared to confront that scourge. In Kenya here, yesterday, the Kenya Medical Practitioners and Dentists Union raised the flag that despite the government's statement to the contrary, in fact, we are not ready to confront Ebola. In the studio this morning, I'm joined by Nelly Bosire, the Vice Chair of KMPDU, to discuss the scourge of Ebola and our state of preparedness. Karibu, Daktari.
Thank you.
Now, give us hope. We are told that we are ready, that the government has set up systems for testing, and if Ebola ever surfaces here, we'll be able to detect it. The doctors, yourselves, the union, says no, we are sitting ducks. What leads to that conviction?
Well, sitting in our houses watching what is going on in the Western African countries is enough to scare all of us. We may claim to be a bit advanced in terms of our medical technology and availability, but our healthcare system has been neglected for a very long time. And when we are going to introduce a scourge this bad, then we honestly are not adequately prepared. Being able to diagnose a disease is not being prepared. Being prepared is putting every measure in place to prevent it from coming into our country.
Right.
And treat. At the point where we are able to confirm it, are we able to handle it?
Right.
So that is
so
what
let's evaluate it at those two levels you have set. One, at the level of being able to prevent it, and then at the level of being able to diagnose it. Are we able to prevent, looking at the mechanisms or measures the government has put in place?
Well, in the issue of such an infectious disease squarely falls under the Ministry of Health, and particularly under the Department of Disease Surveillance. And the team we have has put policies in place, okay? And with what we have, those policies would still be quite a milestone.
Right.
The problem is, are these policies translating to the ground?
In action.
In action. Are they actionable policies?
Yes.
They may be, but are we actualizing them?
Your judgment on that is that we are not, now let's,
yes.
Is that the case?
That is the case.
What makes you believe so? Because this is a verdict on the government's preparedness. What have the medics established to be the faults or the weaknesses in that action towards prevention of the Ebola coming in here? They've said they've set up checkpoints and testing points in Busia and all the border points at the airport. Are you satisfied with the measures taken?
I wouldn't say we are satisfied. Let's start with the border point checks. Our main portal of entry that the focus has been most on has been the airport. Let us look at the airport, and just taking a single example, let us look at what happened at the airport on the weekend when we received a patient from South Sudan.
Yes.
Did that look prepared to you? How did the patient get to the airport without our authorities being aware that we have a patient being brought in who is unwell, severely unwell, this condition, and there's a possibility that we may need to isolate this patient? If that information was there, then we failed miserably. By the time that plane was touching the ground, we expect the team responsible for response should have been on the runway. There should have been an ambulance with trained paramedics or medics to handle this patient. This patient stayed at the airport for how long? We lost her. The question I ask myself now is, what if she did not have Ebola? So did we let a poor woman die with something we could have possibly intervened if we had been better organized? Now, what if she had Ebola? The airport is an open place. How many people came into contact with her? Did we isolate that plane load of passengers who flew in with her? The staff who are working on board? Because if you're suspecting one person, then contact tracing. Are we dealing with contact tracing? this person was on board at a point where we say the disease is more is infectious at the point where the patient is showing symptoms. This patient was bleeding. If that was a criteria to look out for, to suspect her, then everybody she came into contact with should have been isolated.
Including the pilot?
Including the pilots.
So yes. If that woman proves to be yours, Ebola, then the whole load, plane load will be spreading all over the world.
Yes. And that's the concern. So
and then upon arrival, even after she was released to, we presume, the family, what are the precautionary measures?
Is
in
that
the event?
What we should do? Mm. You have a patient suspected of Ebola. You have unconfirmed reports. You have not yet gotten your lab test done to confirm whether it's Ebola or not. How do you release that body? That body is still quarantined until you give it a pass that no, it's not Ebola, and the family can have the body.
All right. So that is a case that just illustrates how unprepared or our systems are not watertight.
And yet the airport is the most watertight point of entry we have.
As far as
so
the government has said.
So imagine what is happening at our border points, especially by road. Yesterday I gave an example of the real reality of the situation. This Ebola outbreak is something we've been dealing with since August. We are in October. In September we isolated a patient who came in through our airport and was denied an entry into the country because he came from a country that's directly affected. This gentleman went to another country and entered Kenya by road. 2 weeks down the line, symptoms are present. Now we are isolating.
Mm.
Okay? That is just an example of how porous our borders are. Look at what Western Asian countries are doing. In the streets of Bangkok, everybody walking around is actually being tested for temperature, not manually, but by, you know, set up technology.
Yes.
And the moment you are picked out as your temperature is high, then immediately you're picked and taken to a center for now the rest of the comprehensive checkup. Now, that means that we're not just looking at foreigners or people coming into our country. We're looking at everybody. And that's what we need to do. I passed through the airport a few weeks back after the Ebola outbreak, and because I was coming home, I was not screened. I was not asked to fill any forms. In fact, when I went to fill one, I was told, oh, you're coming back home, you can go. The person from Port Health who was telling me this did not ask which country I have come from.
Mm.
Did not ask where I have been for the past 1 month. We may step that up right now, but if we already had that leakage at the, you know, at the outset,
and it could be in here, right?
It could. That's why I was. I mean, when we look at the epidemiology of describing these things, we say there are the reported cases which we can give a figure to, but there are cases going unreported. Okay, and when the researchers will make those adjustments, the cases that we are that are going unreported are more than double.
The
numbers that we are having reported.
Right.
So imagine if somebody came into this country, went to their house, lives alone, and gets sick and is not able to call for help and dies in their house. How do we know about such? By the time we find out, it will be very late. How many people will have put themselves in harm's way by coming into contact?
Let's look at the testing systems established at the the entry points,
mm-hmm.
and particularly Jomo Kenyatta Airport. What sort of testing is going on, and is that proof?
Is that adequate
to establish anything?
Well, the first thing is that you fill the health forms, which basically are trying to target people who are high risk versus the low risk and who may require further screening.
Mm.
So from that point alone, if I lie,
yes,
I am in trouble. I may not lie about destination. I may lie about contact.
Yes.
I may lie about having a fever.
Yes.
Because fever is not something that when I have a fever that I am hot until I'm well for the next 2 weeks.
Yes.
You know, it comes and goes. It goes up, it goes down, you take some paracetamol, it might improve a bit. So at that point, if I walk through and lie, it means that we've already created a gap.
Yes.
Now, if you look at the screening protocols, they have been made very wide so that we're able to, we're increasing sensitivity, not necessarily specificity, and that's what screening is all about. So it means that any person who comes in and has a fever and any other symptom of Ebola, just one more,
mm.
and a history of travel to one of the affected countries or contact with someone who's been from those affected countries who's been unwell. Okay, now here's the unfortunate thing about Ebola symptoms. They are not specific.
They're not specific.
To Ebola.
Yes.
It like is fever, like, it's yeah. headaches, it's joint pains, it's, you know, malaise, you're tired, you're fatigued, you're vomiting, you're having diarrhea. How many diseases that we encounter on a daily basis in this country have those symptoms?
Even
malaria, typhoid, anything goes. Yes. So it means that every sick person must be tested, is really what we are implying. Okay? And if we do that, then we are at the point where we are broadening our net. Now, we have captured all these people who are suspects. What more do we do? We are not taking blood samples from all of them. Okay? If we do, and we have to go and test, how good is our contact tracing? If today you don't have symptoms, but there's this history that's a bit hazy, and I decided, let me take your blood sample for testing.
Yes.
After you leave me, I have to follow up with the results, okay? When you go to Western countries, and you are at the airport going through their customs, what's the first thing you list? Where you're staying, what is your contact, who else to be contacted in case of anything? How good are we with that in Kenya?
Which means we are not asking that.
Even if we do, how good are we at contact tracing? We can have, let's say, tourists or people coming in for conferences and what, and we know exactly which hotel this person is staying and we can trace them. But I have come to stay with friends. Today they live in Nairobi. Tomorrow we have gone with them to Masai Mara. To, you know, in fact, the cell phone advent has really helped us. We may be able to make a call. But if you call me and you cannot, I cannot heed your call, how good are we at tracking you physically and saying, you need to be isolated. On top of that, are we? What about all the people you've come into contact with? Because then we have to have a huge net.
The government has said, okay, now we move on from prevention to diagnosis. The government says it's prepared in case they detect a case of Ebola. And they've set up Mbagathi District Hospital here in Nairobi as the Ebola treatment center in the event that happens. What is your association's or union's assessment of that move, and how adequate is it?
In terms of actual diagnosis, we are doing okay. Cambridge CDC, they'll handle that. And actually the protocol is that your job as the clinician is to draw the sample and send it. The moment we start having private hospitals doing these tests on their own, in their own hospitals, we are increasing our risk. Because that's one of the most infectious material that you'll be handling. And anybody who's going to handle this material need to be well prepared, well trained, and in an appropriate lab to handle hazardous material.
Yes.
So we can't prove that for every person, and we're restricting it to the lab tests must be done in the one place. And that we are good, we can handle
that. At Kemri?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
My concern is once we diagnose, now the facilities you're talking about come in. There are very few countries in the world, we're not talking Africa, in the world that have proper isolation facilities. Even the United States of America has four. So what we are doing in Kenya, those centers we've put up and we're telling people are our isolation facilities are actually makeshift. Okay? They are makeshift. And that means that we already are down on one.
Yes.
We don't have a proper isolation facility.
But isn't this a temporary facility that we are trying to set up, the government or the country is trying to set up, because of the nature of the threat? So then somebody would say that is adequate because we only, this is preparatory in the event it happens.
But you see, we've had a lot of these kinds of infections. Hemorrhagic fevers are not new to Kenya.
Yeah.
It's just that Ebola's magnitude is so huge,
yes.
So everybody's talking about it.
Right.
Remember a few years ago we had a series of avian flus, you know, Rift Valley fever, we had avian flu, do not eat pork 1 minute, do not eat beef another time, now the next few months do not eat chicken, do not, you know.
Yes.
And we had all these things.
Yes.
We've had Marburg with us forever. It is not new.
Yeah.
So we can't say we waited for Ebola to
so
think
we, should
we need
have
an isolation.
A center
at least one.
As part of remedial or,
yes.
or
is the government, has the government given in adequate financing for the preventive because I've had complaints that Treasury is having problems.
Well, we do know that at some point there were reports that Treasury had given about 600 million for Ebola preparedness.
Yeah.
Now, for me, I do not know about the value of the money if we're trying to cost it. For me, I'm looking at what has that money done, and if it is too little, do we have backup? Let me give you an example. When Liberia was hit, World Bank released $200 million.
200 million?
Yes. Mm-hmm. How much has that done for you?
Not much.
So the financial implication of containing this disease is astronomical. Do we have that budget? And here's another thing. When you have an epidemic that is crossing borders this fast, there's no one person who can do it for themselves. It has to be a coordinated effort so that every player is involved. So our country will do the best it can. And we hope that other partners, we can work together so that, you know, once you are efficient as a team, then you are going to spend a bit less.
So, okay, is it in your knowledge whether we are operating, or these ministries of these three countries, or the East Africa region is collaborating, and to what extent? Okay, we're talking about Kenya. Are you aware what Tanzania might be doing, and whether they are, you know, a little more prepared than us?
Well, I can't speak for the health professionals
in the region.
Mm-hmm.
Are you having conversations around this thing? Because the tragedy is this, speaking as a Kenyan, we are the medical professionals. The government, Dr. Muraguri, the Director of Medical Services, says we are done, we are happy, we have set up systems to combat this thing.
Mm-hmm.
The professionals in the same side, now acting as a union, mm-hmm. say, look, we're not ready. There are all these gaps. Is there no convergence of opinion on a matter such as grave as this?
Here is the reality. Policy making and such are actually things that are done away from the facilities. As I said, the Department of Disease Surveillance has actually put up a protocol on what is expected of the health workers.
Yes.
Okay? This is what we're dealing with. These are the facts. This is how we plan to achieve prevention. And in case we have it, this is how we plan to achieve management, the containment of this problem.
Yeah.
Now, When us as the people on the ground speak, what we are saying is this. You have those, we don't know them.
Mm. So we can't feel it. We are not the recipients of that, but we don't know them.
Yeah. It is that simple.
So they are speaking about things, but they are strange things to you who are in the same field.
Absolutely. And if you saw in our press conference yesterday, one of the things we're saying, there must be adequate information dissemination.
Mm.
It does not matter that there is a guideline
yes.
that I, on the ground, coming into contact with a patient, don't know about.
Mm.
With all due respect, that is not preparedness. And here's the fact.
Yes.
Today, walk into any hospital and ask a doctor, today if I came to you and I said I have Ebola, what will you do? I am not cheating you. 90% of the health workers will walk away.
Because they don't have the protective gear.
It's
I
not
saw
even
Dr.
about
Martin,
protection.
Martin Lechere saying we don't want to die from
preventable risk.
Risks.
That's
is it
the
that
concern.
Then the health practitioners do not have facilities, the right gadgets, equipment?
We know different facilities have different issues,
yeah.
Okay? But the general conclusion is that there is no coordination.
There is absolutely no system.
Let me ask you this. We have reports of Ebola
yes.
in DRC, Congo,
yes.
which is next to us.
Yes.
There are a lot of people who go to Congo from Kenya in trucks,
mm-hmm.
delivering whatever they're delivering, getting timber, and they are coming by road.
Our truckers. Mm-hmm.
How is that being sorted out? Is anything being done about that?
You know, amazingly, nobody is talking about DRC. DRC has always had Ebola. It is the origin, the first diagnosed cases of Ebola. The name Ebola originates from the DRC. what we have is the focus is so much on the scourge going on in West Africa that we are forgetting that in this year alone, DRC has reported 80 cases of Ebola and confirmed at least 47 people dead.
47 dead in,
now from in Ebola? Our, yes.
How come it hasn't spread as alarmingly as it has in Guinea and Liberia and Sierra Leone?
Because of reporting
those
systems.
Are some, there is reporting systems partly, but also the Ebola virus is not just one. There are subspecies of the virus.
Okay.
And some, we don't know whether they're just more aggressive than others, but
the milder forms of Ebola.
In such epidemics, the diseases that have a higher risk of death tend to be contained a lot faster because they kill off their hosts too fast before they're able to spread it too much. Now, we've traditionally known that Ebola will kill about 90% of the people who will get it. But in this current pandemic, even looking at the figures, we're actually doing around 70%. So we have a population of people who are surviving, and that means that the disease burning out will be slower. That may explain why it has spread so much. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, if we're looking at it from that perspective, then it may explain why in West Africa it's so bad. But I am not the specialist in that. It's yeah. just what
the
we have been able
would
to.
Be.
Yes, would be.
Yeah. Now, there is also the argument that, look, it's medics, medical doctors who are talking.
Yes.
The vets are not talking.
Mm-hmm.
Yet Ebola is an animal disease.
Mm-hmm.
Well, has zoonotic, is a zoonotic
yes.
disease, the animal origins.
Mm-hmm.
Why is that gap existing in our response? There are no vets involved in this response mechanism. Or are there conversations that the public may not be aware of?
I think, first of all, we would say that the stakeholder involvement may not be great, because if the stakeholder involvement was that good, I wouldn't be sitting here today
right.
talking about this. I would
yes.
be talking about this is what we are doing, this is where we are, and these are the measures.
Yes.
So if I, the primary care provider on the ground, was not involved.
Yes.
So can you imagine about the vet?
The vets are not even
yes.
being invited to talk about
to
it.
About
Let's
it.
Go back to the Congo
yes.
and tell me what can be done, because those truck drivers, the way they brought aid, because it came through that the same route, the way the history of aid in this country
mm-hmm.
came through that trucking. What has been done and what can be done?
Well, the current protocol that is out from DSRM actually says, lists three countries. People who have had travel to, then it says Liberia, Guinea, and Sierra Leone. And says, and any other country that may have confirmed cases as this epidemic is rolling out. So I think what we need to do is continuous awareness, even to the people at our screening point, that, hey, we didn't say DRC before, but this is a real threat. And then develop protocols on what do we do with these people. If we stopped Kenya Airways from flying,
yes.
there has to be something we can do about these truckers.
Yeah.
Yeah, in fact, there is
but
a somebody
as
says
anything
we
done.
Have buses traveling.
Not to the best of my
yeah.
knowledge.
Yeah, somebody says we have business people traveling by matatu and buses to Tanzania and back, including, and of course to Uganda, obviously, and to Kigali.
Mm-hmm.
How sure are we that these people may not unconsciously get in contact with people and bring Ebola back home?
That is exactly the reason why we are saying even our screening, how
yes.
good are we? But you know, even for screening, there's only so much you can do. So we cannot vilify the government completely. My concern is there is something that is important that we have not addressed. Today we confirm a case of Ebola. You tell me as a Kenyan, not as a health worker, but as a Kenyan, what do you know? What protocol has the government given you? That if you suspect your neighbor of having Ebola, or your wife in the house, or your child who has come back from college in Kampala, what should you do? What do you know?
Okay, for a moment,
mm-hmm.
because I think some people may watch this show and not understand what, you know, we're talking about prevention and whatnot. But as citizens,
mm-hmm.
what should we do? And perhaps let's spend just a minute or so to talk about how Ebola is transmitted and the symptoms of it for public consumption. Then we resume our pursuit of Ebola.
Thank you for bringing that up. Yeah. That's one of the things we are actually saying.
Yes.
It shouldn't take a Power Breakfast show to let Kenyans know.
The government should have been out
there. The government should have done this from August.
With a loud mouth.
With a very loud mouth.
Yes.
It has the best mouthpieces for this.
Yes.
The government is in contact with churches. People go to churches. Have we taken advantage of those congregations to educate? Have we put out the chief's barazas?
The provincial administration that's now, yes.
Yes, all chiefs these things. We didn't get rid of the provincial administration. These are the things we expect they should be doing.
Yeah.
What mobilization of public awareness have we done? None.
True.
And that's the biggest concern, that we are putting people at risk, not because they will refuse to comply or what, but we haven't even told them what are the do's and don'ts.
Yeah.
Okay? We've said Ebola is a viral disease. It is highly contagious. Any contact with fluids of a person who has Ebola will give you the disease if they come into contact with broken skin on yourself.
So anybody shaking hands, body contact, anything.
Some of the breaks on your skin are so minor, you may not notice them. But if the blood splashes on you, then you're already getting infected. We have mucous membranes, your mouth, your eyes, anything that splashes on you is going to, even sweat. We are talking blood, we are talking sweat, we are talking urine, we are talking saliva, we're even talking semen. So you can even sexually transmit Ebola to your partner.
Yes.
Yeah?
So those are ways by which Ebola is transmitted.
It's transmitted.
The public must be disabused of the notion that you can cough. We can pick it from the air.
Well, I would not talk much about that because currently among the researchers there's a raging debate on the fact about air transmission. Previously it has been known to not.
But if you cough and there is spit in it, of course that means you have transmitted some liquids.
Well, so that's what I'm saying, for me I wouldn't
into
and that's why part of isolation also includes physical separation.
Yes.
That some of these risk factors you're actually trying to protect yourself.
So in short, people should be greeting each other less, saying hi more. Or texting each other.
Okay.
hi.
Well, it's a reality in the countries that are hit.
So if people, if you see somebody, that is how it's transmitted.
Mm-hmm.
Now, just one line again about the symptoms.
Mm-hmm.
If somebody has symptoms of Ebola, what are those?
I had gone through that list before and I will still repeat it for the benefit of the public.
Yeah.
Number one is fever.
Yes.
Okay. And we're talking fevers. What is the cutoff at CDC is 38.5 degrees. So any temperature must first be recorded so that we know where we are. And if you're really going above 38.5, then you're strongly suspicious for Ebola.
Yes.
Now think about all these other symptoms that need to be present. They may not all be there, but knowing that these are the possibilities.
Yes.
We have headache, we have joint pains, we have fatigue, diarrhea, vomiting. All these are symptoms that are common in many other diseases. But that means today, if you are sick, first of all, suspect Ebola and then everything else.
It's
the point.
The
yes. But the telltale sign is always the bleeding.
The bleeding.
Okay. Yeah. And when you talk about bleeding, people expect to see blood flowing out.
Not
before you get to the point where blood is flowing out, there are other signs of bleeding. Spotting under your skin, looking bruised, the eyes turning red. Those are signs of bleeding before the overt bleeding comes in.
Yeah.
Okay. And the unfortunate thing is that by the time we're at the point of bleeding, the disease is very advanced.
Okay. Those are symptoms. Mm. That's what not to do. You know, I hear Ebola comes from animals and all these things that you should not eat, but we are not yet there. I mean, that is the origin of bushmeat.
Maybe I can talk about that a little
bushmeat,
bit.
Mm-hmm. Bats.
Ebola is not completely understood in some aspects.
Yes.
But we have always, I mean, so far the information we have points to that we have the tropical forest fruit bat.
Yes.
That is known to be the natural host. Or thought to be the natural host.
Yes.
Now what that means is that this is the animal in which the Ebola virus lives and multiplies and propagates itself without killing this animal.
Yes.
Can so for in the this, bat it will live its natural lifetime carrying this virus.
Yes.
Okay. What we don't understand is what's the point of contact? How does it jump from that
the bat
to the other animals?
Other animals.
Now, the other animals are inclusive of me and you.
Yes.
Okay? And when it gets into different animals, different responses. The animals we list, humans, non-human primates, are animals that have actually been identified to succumb to the disease. It means that your body doesn't have the structure to adapt to hosting this virus without it killing you. So what does it do? It will kill you. And it has killed these animals.
Yes.
Now, for countries where they actually consume primate meat, that is where the origin of this is a monkey disease. I was talking to my niece, and she's nine years old, and she came from school and told me, we were told Ebola is spread, it comes from monkeys.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And you know, for the people who actually consume this meat.
Those are the primates that the disease migrates to.
Yes.
So we should avoid eating mammals and primates. They are our relatives. It's also abhorrent to eat mammals, like bats, like monkeys. Those are our relatives. We should avoid those, the mammals and the primates.
You talked about Jomo Kenyatta Airport. You never talked about Busia and other areas and see the adequacy of the preparedness.
I thought
they had said they put up centers there, but I don't know how equipped already to deal with all people walking in by foot or by road.
By bicycle.
I mean, people will walk across the border and have the opportunity of visiting there this weekend. People walk around. You avoid the main customs place. People walk around. People on foot don't get checked. So I don't know whether they are stopping everybody who is walking across the border, or I don't know what they're doing.
You know, a few days back, I was listening to a fisherman in Western Africa being interviewed. And he said, yes, we know customs is there, but when we go out to fish in the ocean, we always cross borders. We even land on other countries' soil, trade, and go back home.
Yeah.
And they don't come into contact with the screening officials. But they are coming into contact with the locals. They are trading with the locals.
Yes.
So for them, that became a point to mark. For us, our roads are as porous as it gets.
Yeah.
Especially our border points into Tanzania and Uganda, because first we have the East African community. So your requirement to cross is not there.
Because of the
community.
Yeah. Now, let's pursue that disease, the origins of it a little more, and deal with the propaganda. A lot of it is being spread out there. I've had stuff going on that, look, this is a black man's disease. There's propaganda that even the medicine that has been invented, the drugs that are being applied, they're not being applied on black people.
Mm-hmm.
Stuff like that. What are the facts established?
Well, there is
for those who believe this is a white man's disease to kill blacks.
Well, we said the same thing about HIV and got stuck there for 10 years and lost precious time where we could have actually stopped this epidemic on its tracks.
Yeah.
We are going about the same problem, okay?
Yes.
We have stated what the facts are. Diseases are usually identified, and they'll always be what we call the index person. The first person to be diagnosed with this disease may not necessarily be the first person to have this disease.
Yes.
Okay? Let me give you a very well-documented example of Marburg, which is Ebola-like.
Yes.
Okay? The first documented deaths from Marburg were actually in Germany, in a place called Marburg, where it got its name from.
Yes.
But it had been imported from Uganda, because Europe was buying monkeys from Uganda for research and vaccine development.
Right.
Okay? So, being the primates that suffer the same disease, it means some diseased monkeys made their way there, and the first person documented to die was actually the person responsible for their care in the cages, cleaning out and feeding them, and he was the first person.
Yes.
And he died of the disease, and everybody was like, what is this? And from that, they were able to establish this is a virus, it looks like this, it seems to work like that.
Mm.
It seems to have been brought by this animal. But any scientist will tell you, any animal that dies that fast from an infection, a viral infection, is not the natural host.
Okay.
And this is how we came back to thinking about the fruit bat.
Yes.
All right?
So
when we look at it that way,
yeah.
There is no such thing as a black man's disease or a white man's disease. This is a disease that attacks you because genetically you are a human being.
Right. Now,
what about the treatment? There was a treatment. There was a some.
MZAP.
Yes, the one that was given to the Americans, and they got healed.
Well, we do not have any drug right now that is approved for use for treatment of Ebola. That does not mean that research has not been ongoing. Okay? Mm. Research has been ongoing. In any other normal setup, this research for Ebola should have been spearheaded by Africa for Africa. What is our investment in research?
Very small.
Okay? So the people who think that we may not have this disease, but it could be a possible threat to us, have invested millions in doing what?
Research.
In researching this disease. If a drug is not yet approved, it is not out there for circulation. But in America, there are rules of research that say you can take in someone as a clinical trial patient. And they have their criteria for it. So this is the reason why they were able to test it on their people,
yes,
which we cannot force them to extend to Africa.
So that's why I'm saying they are only treating their people, mm-hmm, and the Africans are dying and they're not being given that medicine. Why are they not giving that medicine?
If it healed those two if it healed those two people, why can they give it to others?
As I said, the protocol for research,
it does not
for
allow
you
them
to get
to
approval to use this drug, it is a very long process.
But Daktari, are you saying that drug is still not being applied?
It's
it
not
hasn't
yet
been extended
approved
to West Africa. Are you saying that drug, whatever it is name, whatever numbers they are, I know names up, is not in Kenya?
No, it's not.
So if we get hit by Ebola, we are sitting there to die, right?
Oh, yes.
Why are we not in any sort of protocol with Americans to also do clinical trials here?
You know, what you're asking is, you've been doing this for the last 45 years. Now I'm hit. Please allow me to enjoin.
Because I wasn't party to it.
Because I was not party to it. Did we have rules? Because we are the very same people. When our people are drafted for these kinds of clinical trials, are the first ones to raise a red flag and say what?
Guinea pigs.
We are being used as guinea pigs.
Right.
That brings us to the Catholic Church. And
well, so we have cleared all the beliefs about Ebola. Mm-hmm. There's nothing black white about it. It's a human, it's a genetic issue. There's no drug available, but there's a clinical one being used to treat the patients, especially those who have been
still on trial. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Taken to the US, mm-hmm, although some have died still.
Yes.
But that drug is being applied in West Africa, though.
Well, I can't speak for that.
Okay.
Okay, I can't speak for that.
About before we get to the tetanus answer, I want to clear with Ebola. Now, our doctors have gone to West Africa.
Yes.
We have sent a team to rescue, to also get experience and to work.
Mm-hmm.
What exactly happened? Or what is our contingent there?
That is what we also would like to know, as doctors.
These doctors,
are they not your members?
What the left hander is doing,
you know,
the right hand.
you just nailed it.
Yes.
The right hand is doing something. The left hand is completely unaware. Just like you in the press,
really?
I have heard. Okay?
Yes, sometimes.
But there has been no official communication that
how is
this
it that members. Okay, fine. Let me approach this, Dr. Bosire.
Mm-hmm.
You are all members of the Kenya Medical Association.
Mm-hmm.
Decisions, I guess, that are far reaching or consequent over such tragedies as this,
mm-hmm,
must have some common knowledge of common information. How did those doctors go? Were they recruited? Did they volunteer? Was there an invitation to volunteer? Or how
I
did
think,
this happen?
I remember before I said we have a whole department dedicated to this, but it's a small department. It doesn't have very many people because these are not things that happen every day, and the human resource involved is not so big. Okay, so here we are. How they choose who goes and who doesn't go, I cannot speak for them. They know best. Okay, and I mean, it's not even important. What is important is you went on a fact-finding mission. What have you found out? And kindly disseminate this information to every important stakeholder. That is really the issue of concern. And on the same vein, we have these protocols that we have talked about. These also need to be disseminated to every healthcare worker. And this is not just the doctor, the nurses, the lab technicians, the mortuary attendants. Everybody needs to know what do these protocols say. Let me give you a good example. We fumbled a lot with HIV. But if I walked into a dispensary in Kuria today,
yes,
and I walked into Kenyatta National Hospital, the protocol of management is the same. What that person there knows about HIV and its care is the same thing that the person in the National Referral Hospital knows. That's what we want.
That hasn't been done with Ebola.
It has not
been done. That's
and that right there is our gaping hole.
Yeah. That's government public campaign on Ebola, precautionary measures, the do's and don'ts. I mean, they can check out, you know, small space in municipals and say this and this. If you see this, do this. I mean, obviously,
they have done
basic things.
A bit of that, yes. Like the Standard carried a story last week. We need a very strong media presence. And sometimes Kenyans generally may not pay much attention to important things in the media. But we have to find a way to make everybody sit up and pay attention. Look, for example, in Liberia.
Yes.
Who is the primary campaigner? The president herself.
Yes.
Has our president said anything?
Not a word.
Anything
in a
whatsoever about
Ebola. President Obama spoke about it yesterday,
yes,
the other day.
Mm.
He told Americans, relax.
Yes.
Our risk or likelihood of getting Ebola is low, but these are the precautions. Now, America is alert.
Yes.
Really alert.
And that is what we're saying.
There, you know,
there are things that require a lot of political goodwill. That whether we like it or not, we have to pay attention. And we have to have specific people strongly talking about it that will get the nation talking.
Yes.
And once they do, then people are curious to go out of their way and get more information.
We'll ask the first lady to adopt Ebola as a side campaign to the zero campaign. But Mutegi, let's go to tetanus.
Yeah, the Catholic Church is up in arms about the vaccination of women between, is it 17?
15 to 49.
Yes. Why them?
Again, very sad issue. The public is being treated to two different perspectives,
yeah,
from
mm-hmm.
medical professionals and the and fact of faith now coming in. What is this? What are the facts on the tetanus vaccination going on?
What I will not be in a position to speak about is why the Catholic Church has taken this position. I think that will best come from them.
Yeah.
But from the medical perspective, tetanus vaccine is not a new vaccine. It is a vaccine that has been there for over 100 years. All of us here today, when our mothers were pregnant with us, they were given the tetanus vaccine. When we were born, between 1 month and 3 months, we were all given the tetanus vaccine. When you get in an accident, you get injured, you have a cut wound, when you go to the hospital, the
tetanus.
First thing you're given is a tetanus vaccine. So it is not a new vaccine. The only thing that has been new about it is that we have a campaign that is currently running for tetanus vaccines. It is not the first campaign. If you look in the history of our country, every year we have drought, we do the measles campaign. Look at the polio campaign. It has run for how many years now? We've forgotten.
Yes.
But we know, we always hear
there's
the polio campaign is
running.
Permanently ongoing.
Yeah. Mm.
Okay? One risk factor comes in, we run these campaigns again. The target of campaigns is usually to make sure you're trying to reach everybody. Because when you're looking at scheduled vaccinations, the person who should get the vaccine can opt out. If you don't bring your baby to the clinic for vaccination,
yes,
I have no way of tracking you and saying you must. All right?
Mm.
If you're pregnant and you do not go to the antenatal clinic, I have no way of tracking you and saying, even if you're not coming, let me find you somewhere and vaccinate you.
Yes.
So what do we do? Campaigns aim to target the people, population at risk.
So how is this, the women of 15 or 14 like that?
The claim actually that has gone out is that women are being they're vaccinating 19 to 49. That is the age bracket.
Why the women of that age?
The question then is why, and that's what the Catholic Church is taking up the issue with.
Mm-hmm. Now, why?
What is the benefit?
That's what we're going to talk about.
Yes.
Why are we doing it in the first place? What is the campaign?
Yes.
The campaign is to reduce neonatal and maternal deaths.
which means what in
newborn
English?
Newborn children under 28 days and women in the reproductive age group.
Yes.
Okay? Who are liable to become pregnant.
Mothers, yes.
All right? Now, the first thing is that any baby under 28 days does not have the tetanus vaccine. Is not even eligible to receive the vaccine at that age.
Okay.
The only protection they have is the protection against tetanus that they carry from their mothers as they are born.
Right.
All right? Now, that is the explanation as to why we vaccinate these women in pregnancy. I vaccinate you, the mother. I make you make antibodies that protect you against tetanus. These antibodies passively pass from you into your baby, and the ones that the baby is born with protect them for a certain duration to allow them to mature enough to be able to get the vaccine, and it works in them.
Well, somebody is going to challenge you. In fact, the doctors who are behind the Catholic position are arguing that there is an addition of a certain ingredient in this particular vaccine, the HCG, that is making it that once it's taken, it makes it difficult for a woman of childgiving a birth, you know, conception, makes conception difficult.
Mm-hmm.
Is this fact being shared, or is this, how true is this?
Well, first I'll look at it from two angles. Number one, we need to understand what is beta HCG, because the perception out there is that this is a toxin, this is a bad thing. Beta HCG is actually a hormone that every pregnant woman produces, and this hormone is responsible for sustaining your pregnancy inside you until the baby is mature enough to be born. Okay? It's actually made by the placenta. And
right.
We all know that the only person who has a placenta is a pregnant woman.
Yes.
Okay? And once the baby is born, the baby goes with their placenta, and the beta HCG levels in the woman are going to drop because the factory has gone with the baby.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay? Now, we have been able to manufacture this hormone. All right? And we use it for various reasons. This is the advent of all drugs. But the most important use of beta HCG is actually treatment of infertility.
Mm.
You've heard of women who go for IVF.
Yes.
They're given beta HCG to make their ovaries mature a lot of eggs, which are then harvested for the IVF.
Yes.
Okay? It's one of the two drugs that are used routinely. All right?
Okay.
Now, the second aspect is this HCG being vilified. What happened? In the past, we've had reports, and these are not scientifically reported reports. They are case reports from certain people, and we cannot quite say what their interest in this was. But these tetanus campaigns have run across the world. It's not unique to Kenya. And at some point in the early 80s and the late 70s, these campaigns were running in other countries. If you go online and actually look this up, you will actually find this report of the campaign that ran in Mexico, in Philippines, and in Nicaragua. And the women were getting vaccinated, and when someone tested the vaccines, they said that they contained traces of beta HCG. Okay? Now, this was the beginning of why is it there in the first place? I cannot answer that. Okay?
Yes.
But WHO was vilified. They said that this beta HCG, once it's given with the tetanus vaccine, the body, as the body is making antibodies against tetanus, that it will make antibodies against beta HCG. And that means, because these antibodies remain in you, that at the point where you get pregnant and you need to make the beta HCG, that these antibodies will destroy the beta HCG, and that will render you impossible to be able to sustain this pregnancy because your beta HCG is now not working.
Right.
Those are scientific explanations that require to be backed with research.
Okay.
Okay. Now, the gap here is that we don't have any follow-through research. Has it shown that you can have the antibodies, but is there documented evidence, reproducible, ethical, that has been done the way research should be done, that shows that every woman who has gotten this a significant proportion of them have actually suffered repeat miscarriages, because that would be information to make us sit up and listen. I don't fault the Catholic Church for raising this issue. My concern is that what they are raising is being misinterpreted to read that the vaccine is the problem. Okay?
Yes.
Not this beta HCG, which we haven't done enough research
so
about.
So the idea
to
is
know.
That, but somebody still asks, for example, that mm-hmm. why are men not being vaccinated against
tetanus? Because men don't get pregnant.
Well, yes, and we just explained that.
Yeah,
that
men don't get pregnant. Whatever. It's intended for a baby who is going to be born.
All right. I think, Daktari, I should not stretch you any more than that. Thank you for coming, Dr. Nelly Bosire, the Vice Chair of the Kenya Medical Practitioners and Dentists Union, was joining us to clarify on the preparedness of the country to combat Ebola if it does arrive here. And the question, I mean, from what we've discussed, there's a lot to be done, work to be done. Government needs to step up its initiative. And there is need for system-wide consultations and greater publicity to achieve safety against that. And tetanus, she says, nothing wrong with it. Go and take your tetanus injection, despite alarm being raised by the Catholic Church. I hope it's a ongoing discussion. We'll hear from them in future. Thank you for watching Power Breakfast, and thank you for coming.
Thank you.